Your project could be facing a hidden danger that could destroy their energy efficiency, cost you and your clients hundreds, even thousands of dollars each year, and even negatively impact the health of the building occupants. That's right, we're talking about thermal bridges. They're invisible and often overlooked, but will definitely sabotage the energy efficiency of your projects if you don't take care of them. My name is Anton Dobrovsky, I'm a passive house trainer, and I've taught hundreds of professionals how to design energy-efficient buildings. And in this video, we're gonna uncover the invisible danger of thermal bridges for our health, buildings, and wallets, and I'll show you how to use the Thermal Triad Method to make thermal bridge-free designs. But first, let's define what a thermal bridge is. Simply put, thermal bridges, sometimes also called cold bridges, are the areas of the building envelope where the heat flow is different, in most cases significantly higher, in comparison with the surrounding areas. This means that the more heat is lost through these areas, resulting in temperature fluctuations and an increase in the energy consumption. These are usually areas where there is either less insulation or no insulation at all, or the insulation is penetrated by an element with higher thermal conductivity. And there are two types of thermal bridges, linear and punctual. Linear thermal bridges could be floor-to-wall connections, projecting balcony slabs, outer corners, roof eaves, but also even the wooden studs in the exterior walls. And these are calculated with the psi-value. Point thermal bridges, on the other side, are single penetrations in the thermal envelope, like columns, mounting brackets for balconies, and even insulation fasteners. The point thermal bridges are measured with the he-value. So, all in all, you can think of thermal bridges like highways for the heat to escape from the inside to the outside, because through these places, we are losing the heat much faster compared to the uninterrupted part of the assembly. And this can lead to energy losses, increased costs, and even health problems. However, despite those dangers, thermal bridges are often overlooked, underestimated, or even ignored in building design. Why is that? Well, it's because identifying and addressing them can be a complex and time-consuming process, requiring specialized knowledge and expertise. Additionally, thermal bridges are often invisible to the naked eye, making them easy to miss during the design phase. And as a result, they're often not included in the energy models, which can lead to higher energy losses, increased costs, and even unhealthy living environment. Now that we understand what thermal bridges are and why they're often overlooked, let's dive into the dangers that they pose to our buildings, our health, and our environment. First and foremost, thermal bridges are a major contributor to energy loss in buildings and can be responsible for up to 30% of the building's heat losses. And this means that buildings with thermal bridges require more energy to maintain a comfortable temperature, resulting in higher greenhouse gas emissions and a negative impact on the environment. But the consequences of thermal bridges don't stop there. Due to the higher heat losses, the temperature of the interior surface near the thermal bridge is lower, and if the spot becomes too cold, it could result in moisture buildup and condensation, which can then lead to mold growth and decreased indoor air quality. And having mold in your building is very dangerous, leading to asthma attacks and other respiratory illnesses, which is definitely something we want to avoid. In addition to health risks, thermal bridges can also cause structural damage to buildings over time, because the increased moisture and condensation can lead to decay of the building materials, which can compromise their integrity and the integrity of the structure and lead to costly repairs. So it's clear that thermal bridges pose a serious threat to both our wallets and our health. But what can we do to prevent them and mitigate their effects? Well, for this, our buildings should be thermal bridge free. But what does thermal bridge free actually mean? The definition for thermal bridge free design, according to the Pascal standard, which is the go-to standard for high performance and energy efficient buildings, is that the psi-value, which again is what we use to measure thermal bridges, should be lower or equal to 0.01 watts per meter Kelvin. And you might be wondering, how can we effectively design thermal bridge-free buildings? Well, the answer lies in the Thermal Triad Method, which comprises three essential design principles to help us create buildings with minimal thermal bridging. The first principle of the Thermal Triad Method is identification. We have to identify or find the spots where we're going to have potential thermal bridges. And for this, we use the pencil rule. So you should take all the plans and sections of the building, take a pencil, very important because it's called the pencil rule, right? And on each of the plans, start drawing a line along the thermal envelope of the building, or in our words, the heated part of the building. And wherever there is something happening with the insulation, Draw a circle at these points. Whether it's gonna be changing direction, the thickness is different, or another material goes through it, at any of these points, draw a circle, and these are then the details on which we should focus and pay careful attention to. And it's important to address thermal bridges early on in the design process, as they can be much more difficult and expensive to fix once the construction has begun. The second design principle of the thermal triad method is avoidance. You should avoid any thermal bridges, and there should be a single continuous insulation layer all around the thermal envelope of the building. And all insulation layers of the walls, the roof, and the floor should be connected with each other. And the easiest way to avoid the majority of the thermal bridges is by using exterior insulation. So exterior insulation is going to solve a lot of the problems, and in any case we should avoid penetrating the insulation. However, it's not always possible. In some cases, we'll have to penetrate the insulation layer, and here comes the third and final point. The third principle of the thermal triad method is optimization and minimization. Some thermal bridges cannot be avoided, and it's not always possible to make all the details thermal bridge free. Well, in this case, the only option is to optimize them and minimize the heat losses. For this, we use dedicated softwares for thermal bridge calculations, and based on the results, we determine what the impact of the thermal bridge will be on the energy efficiency, but also which parts of the detail can be optimized. Here are two examples. In the example on the left, we have an unoptimized detail for the balcony connection, and on the right, we have the optimized one. And you can clearly see the difference between both in the isotherms. Isotherms are the lines that represent areas of equal temperature on a thermal image. So they help us visualize temperature differences across a building's envelope and identify areas of increased heat transfer, such as thermal bridges. And ideally, they should be straight and equally spaced from each other. On the left, they're quite disrupted due to the balcony slab, which just goes through the insulation layer, while on the right, that's not the case, meaning the thermal bridge is optimized. So what can we do to minimize the heat losses through the thermal bridges and optimize them? The first thing is to use thermal breaks. Thermal breaks are special components or materials used to minimize the heat transfer between the inside and the outside through a building's envelope. Examples of thermal breaks include insulated window and door frames, thermally broken facade anchors, or thermal break systems for balcony connections. And if thermal breaks are not an option, then you can use materials with lower thermal conductivities to reduce the thermal bridges. Because again, by using materials that are less conductive to heat, you can minimize the heat transfer through the building structure. Examples of such materials are wood, PVC, and foam glass. And going back to the two examples with the balconies, you can see that the balcony on the left has a 10 times higher psi-value than the one on the right, which means that through this balcony we'll be losing 10 times more energy. And exactly because of this, we should make our buildings thermal bridge free. So minimizing and optimizing the thermal bridges is essential for improving the energy efficiency of our building and reducing the negative impacts on the environment, our health, and the building performance. And by having good continuous insulation and optimizing the thermal bridges, we can design and construct more efficient and sustainable buildings. And you might be wondering, okay, but how thick should my insulation be to have the maximum energy savings without overpaying for insulation? And that's exactly what I discussed in my last video, so make sure to check it out right here. I hope you enjoyed this one, thanks for watching, and see ya next time.